least you got a place to sit this time, right?
After a test drive, I'm leaving again.
If this is 4 hours,
I don't know.
Somebody's going to pay. And I don't mean monetarily. I mean, it's going to be...
I like the one sound. That's the first time that's ever happened. It's
called 4 hours. Crazy.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for coming this morning. The Speaker's Committee on Workforce Standards and Development is about to convene. It is our intention to conduct this meeting with the courtesy and decorum expected of us as representatives, and we would ask you to please help us attain that goal. At this point, we will open the hearing on House Bill 582, Representative Curtis. Go ahead when you're ready, sir. Pardon me, I need a roll call. Madam Secretary, please call the roll.
Chairman Blaine?
Here.
Vice Chair Dorman?
Here.
Representative Weber?
Here.
Representative Bratton?
Here.
Burns?
Here.
Fraker?
Here.
Gosen? Hurst? Kelly? Lynch? Smith?
Present.
Walker?
Present.
We do have a quorum. Representative Curtis, go ahead when you're ready.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, committee, for having me. It's Black History Month, and nearly 50 years after the Civil Rights Act, and we're still fighting for equality. This bill is only about equality and providing opportunities to people that, without this assistance, will be left out of the next industrial boom in Missouri, given that we have projects from Cortex to the Metropolitan Sewer District to the Boeing expansion, as well as a potential new football stadium. Given that the state has recently completed a disparity study showing that minorities don't have equal access to opportunities in Missouri, as a result of this bill, hopefully the governor will also issue an executive order providing goals or establishing them so that minorities can have an opportunity to equally participate in the workforce. My track record when it comes to labor is unimpeachable. I have a 100% voting record, and I've even lost a job due to being outspoken against illegal contracting, contract labor usage, the systematic removal of overtime from timesheets. I fought for undocumented rights in terms of having equal access to state education. I've even fought against the widespread use of E-Verify, which is detrimental to some. I fought for seniors to have lower utility rates, as well as for students to have a predictable tuition rate, given that businesses often argue for certainty, yet we fail to give it to our future. In filing this bill, it came about because of historical issues that my community has faced within the building trades. If you do a quick Google search, you'll see that the building trades have had issues with practices of inequality for quite a while. It's not a new thing, it's existed historically. You can see something happening in Philadelphia, Chicago, and even Ohio, and even in my hometown of St. Louis. That works for some, but it doesn't work for me. And it doesn't work for the people that I'm fighting for. The same people that are fighting for the American dream that some of us have obtained. Arbitrary barriers based on previous good deeds should not be afforded to people that have practices of legal discrimination in place or actively work to continue a culture of nepotism and other unseemly behaviors. Some of those behaviors are manifested in the policies that have been put forth in St. Louis City and already passed and enacted in St. Louis County. in enacting that legislation in St. Louis County, the legislation actually made it anti-competitive for minority contractors to get a fair shake. Now, this isn't just about the minority contractors, it's about the minorities that are within the unions as well as those that are not within the union. What you will hear today is a lot of testimony. You'll hear that labor has afforded me a good life. And I'd argue that that same quality of life is not possible with just union membership in the building trades today. You'll hear that labor allowed me to put my kids through college. With the rising cost of college and the lack of projects and the ability to get some people, some minorities that are in the building trades out of the apprenticeship programs, the prospects of doing so are becoming less available. Furthermore, college alone today is no guarantee that one will succeed in life. All the more reason why we need to remove the barriers to entry into the building trade so that we give everybody an opportunity to achieve the American dream. Being a right to wage, you'll also hear that being a right to work state leads to lower wages, bad health outcomes, and poor education ones. If you come to my community, I show you that all of the things that the building trades should afford to members, they already exist. My school district that I graduated from is flanked by two non-fully accredited school districts. The individuals in my community before the Affordable Care Act previously didn't have an opportunity to get health care other than accessing it through Medicaid. And partially the reason is if they did want to become a member of the building trades, either they didn't get into the apprenticeship program or they didn't make it out of there. There's a lot of issues within the building trades, and again, doing a quick Google search will show you those. But I can't say that they're doing everything wrong because they did give us a pre-apprenticeship program. I'd ask you to ask those members that say something about the building trades if they put their sons in the pre-apprenticeship program. That's not the gold standard. It's getting into the actual apprenticeship program and then ultimately getting out. But if we leave people in the apprenticeship program, are we doing what we're supposed to be doing? You'll also hear that right to work, or as I like to call it, the Workforce Opportunity Improvement Act will lead to a free rider program. I guess it could be a free rider program, but that already exists as well. It exists in the fact that the trades, the building trades that is, are getting a free ride off of the good works in terms of diversity that the other unions do. They're not practicing it in their own building trades. So the free rider program does exist. The building trades are also, and many times, the sole collective bargaining agents, but that's only because they choose to be. They don't have to be. But from a business perspective, you would want to be the sole collective bargaining agent because you get more money, and it gives you the ability to continue to do what you've been doing for years without any fear of actually having to change. This is what you won't hear. You won't hear that union members support the Workforce Opportunity Improvement Act. The sad truth is people do. I actually spoke to a shop steward roughly about a month ago, and he actually said that some of his members do. I don't know what the number is, but it's not 100% union. 100% of the union is not against right to work or the Workforce Opportunity Improvement Act. You won't hear them say that we have no issues with diversity, because they do. You also won't hear them say that minorities have equal access and opportunity within the building trades to both get into apprenticeships and to get out of them. One of the things in my community is things are about economics. So for the record, I shop at Walmart. I do because for me it's about economics. It's the same way for a lot of members of the unions, minority members. Some people are 100% supportive, and those that actually make more money than the minorities are, some people are 100% supportive, and those that don't make the same amount as their Caucasian counterparts, they typically look at their pocketbook differently. And that's what, you know, allows them to shop at a Walmart, because it's not about the union being 100% right for them. It's not about the union doing everything right. Their pocketbook only affords certain things. There's a statistic out there that says that the average minority member makes roughly $100 less per week than their Caucasian counterparts. I don't understand how that is when they're doing the same job and they have the same skills and training. You also will hear, you will not hear that there are minorities in leadership positions in the building trades. I've been asked by a number of individuals if they could come and talk to me. I'm still waiting to talk to somebody that is in that position, that looks like me, or that fights for the same things that I fight for. I haven't seen that person yet. Lastly, you won't hear stories about people that have been in the building trades, or that had to go to another industry because of no opportunities within them. And that's largely speculation, but maybe it's because of the same strong arm tactics that have been used to prevent me from sponsoring this bill and presenting it to you today. I've had lots of calls and emails, and I actually picked up the phone yesterday. I don't scare easily. A lot of people didn't have answers as to why minorities don't get a fair shake in building trades. I don't have the answer to that either. I do have a solution, though. It's in the Workforce Opportunity Improvement Act. With that, I'll save my closing if the chair will allow, and I'd open it up to any questions that individuals may have.
Thank you, Representative. Do members of the committee have questions? Representative Weber.
Quiet, Mr. Chairman.
Go ahead.
Zillman, last year we had a bill, a right-to-work bill on the floor of the House, and you voted no on that bill, didn't you?
Yes.
Why did you vote no on that bill last year?
At the time, I wasn't prepared for this fight. Now I am.
So you voted no last year because you weren't prepared?
For this fight. I was just a freshman. I'm a sophomore now.
So there's no policy reason you voted no last year?
If you would have asked me if I had issues with the building trades, or if I thought all of the unions were 100% for equality, I would have told you no. Sometimes the reason that we support things in this body are not because they're 100% right or wrong. It's just what we choose to do. I'm not towing that line anymore. It's time for change.
Okay, so I've been to your district.
You have?
And you were very kind and showed me around.
I appreciate you coming.
I appreciated that
You're
as well.
And I have a few Democrats that actually came there during the situation that we had in person.
And I agree that you have problems in your district.
I do.
I absolutely agree with that. What I have a difficult time understanding is why you think the solution is to tear other people down rather than try to lift all communities up.
If I get this correctly, you're saying that I'm tearing people down and the building trades have systematically torn people down that are members of their union?
When we've had other issues, and I'm trying to stay focused on this bill, but
this is only about the building trades.
I'm trying to stay focused on this bill, but I know that you've mentioned other things as well. Have members from the building trades talked to you when they were fighting for raising minimum wage increases? Have you seen them fight for that?
It's likely.
Have you seen them fight against employment discrimination bills?
As I have, and I'm also sponsoring this. So
you absolutely have.
Latitude in terms of change.
Have you seen them fight against that bill?
Who specifically?
The folks, the building trades.
Building trades workers.
Yes.
I don't know. I can't speak to that.
You can't speak to whether you
I can't
it.
Say that the building trade specifically sat in this building and fought for
they
it.
Absolutely.
I can
have.
Say that SEIU,
absolutely
I can have. Say that UAW,
building and trades
I can
have.
Say individuals such as that have come by my office and have consistently fought for the things that I would fight for.
I understand that. Let me ask one other question, because I understand, I think, why you're filing this bill, because you're angry at a specific.
Not angry. Not at all.
Okay.
I want what's good for my community. And having access to the jobs with the pending potential football stadium coming, with the Cortex project, who actually stated that, you know, we can add minorities in the second phase. I'm fighting for those opportunities. It's about the future, it's not about the past. But in filing this bill, I have to give you some historical context and show you that the building trades have been treated minorities and other unfavorable people in their unions fairly.
Okay, well, I strongly disagree, and just to prevent myself from saying anything I later regret, I'm going to cease my questions. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I appreciate that, Mr. Mentor.
Representative Gosin?
To inquire, please.
Go ahead.
Representative, just a couple of questions.
Sure.
you're kind of saying there's a difference between the building trades.
Absolutely.
Then, and could you give me a little more? I mean, I'm unfamiliar with that. What is the difference? And if you can say why, I think you said you really don't know why, but.
From speaking with individuals that have been disaffected from the building trades, there's been historical issues in terms of the access to the apprenticeship programs. That's people actually getting into them. But then also in people getting out of them. When I say people, I'm speaking primarily of minorities and, again, unfavorable people that aren't either, I guess, family and friends of those that are already in there. I guess minorities in general.
Like, would a machinist at Boeing, or you're saying they do, the machinist at Boeing do a better job than, like, an electrical contractor
I'm not bringing quality into this discussion. What we're talking about is access to what could afford people the American dream. So if the building trades are good for everybody and you can go in and you can have a good quality life, you can put your kids through college, you can have a comfortable retirement, then that means that everybody should have the opportunity to partake in that. So if there are things that are systematically preventing people from getting that, then I want to remove those barriers so everybody can achieve the American dream.
And could you explain a little more about the pre-apprenticeship program?
Sure, it's a farce. Basically, as I stated, if you ask the union members that are to come, if they will put their sons and daughters in a pre-apprenticeship program, which doesn't guarantee you an opportunity to get into an apprenticeship, they likely say no, but I'll just guess that they're going to say yes today. But if you tell me how many people have actually entered the pre-apprenticeship program, and are actively in an apprenticeship program today now, I'm guessing we're not gonna have that many as well, but that's just business as usual. I'm trying to change business as usual. That doesn't work.
So I guess the program was expected for people to make it through, and then when you looked at the numbers entering the full apprentice program, that it would be an appropriate number of minorities and non-minorities in that? I mean, is that an area of contention here?
I believe that's the intent, but the intent has supposedly been there for, let's just say, for 15 years or more. So there's only so long that you can work on a problem before you, I guess, either come to a solution or don't. We haven't come to a solution yet. So this is my solution.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Representative Smith?
Don't worry, Mr. Chair.
Go ahead. Have you ever been a member of a building trade?
No, have you?
I'm asking a question.
I hear you.
So you'll answer. So no is the answer to that. Last year, you actually voted for a sales tax increase, correct?
Is that for the transportation industry?
Yes.
To create more jobs? Yes.
You did?
I did.
You know who that directly benefited?
Who?
The building trades.
Did it?
It did.
Okay.
But you knew this because you researched it and you voted for it based off of that, right?
Exactly. And if you look at my record, I voted against it the first year.
I'm asking you. Answer the questions I ask, please, not make up.
And with the hope of additional jobs, then yes, you would vote for that.
Okay. So you voted for it. So what's a construction job? Because that's what I'm asking you. What's a construction job?
It's a job that would come from being affiliated with the building trades. A number of entities that are associated with
the
building trades.
Give me a construction job. Give me an example of like five construction jobs.
Five. I'm not a union member, but
you've got a bill that's impacting.
The pipe fitters would fall in line, would they not? Would the carpenters not? Would the bricklayers not?
Yes.
Okay, who else?
So that's three.
With two more. Like an electrician?
Hey, I think I've proved the point.
No, I'm asking you a question. Do you have two more?
I hear you. And you know what? I forgive you. I understand what you have to do.
Is there?
I get that.
Is there, and you don't want to go down that route. Trust me. Is an electrician?
Yes.
I would believe
so. Can you answer?
I was trying to answer the question. If you could ask for the chair to ask the audience to be silent.
Well, you just did. So is an electrician?
I would believe so, but I can't. If we want to, you know,
I'm just asking.
We want to argue over particulars and not the actual issue.
A yes or no.
The question is.
It's a yes or no question. It's an electrician.
That's a complex question.
Okay, so I'm trying to establish what a construction.
What are you trying to get to?
I'm trying to establish you have construction industry in your bill. You're not going to throw me off my game. I've done this for a long time, so it's not. That won't work with me.
So you supported the industry.
So what I'm saying
is. Doesn't give your community jobs.
What I'm saying is,
An electrician would be a construction industry job, correct?
I would assume so.
So anybody wanting wire on a line would be a building trade construction industry job?
You could let me know if I'm wrong, but I would assume so.
But you are wrong.
Okay.
Because what you're attempting to do, and you
even
stated,
the playing field?
Cannot. No, actually, tell me, how does your bill even the playing field?
By removing this barrier that's been there historically, it will provide everybody the opportunity.
What barrier?
The barrier.
So, all right, so we're going to go in a hypothetical situation. So just say you have an apprentice person with a so-called building trade who has some very discriminating tactics when it comes to bringing in new apprentices. How does right to work change this person's mind to start bringing in somebody different?
Tell me, but there are other avenues.
So what is your bill?
There are other avenues that they can go down in order to become an apprentice.
They can
do that
now.
You don't have to go through the union.
They can do that now. You can go to Rankin or Vatterot and become...
But do you know that in the city of St. Louis that roughly
I don't live
over
in the city of St. Louis. I live in St. Louis
County. You used
County,
to live there.
And you're starting to talk about something. It's not about you.
I hear you.
If you want to ask
it's
questions,
not about you
I'll file the bill, and then you ask me
please
a question when I testify. So my thing is, how does your bill fix that discriminatory person bringing people in? How does it fix it? How does going right to work fix that?
So...
No, I mean, answer the question.
I'm going to answer
don't
the question.
Don't pose another question. Answer that question.
I'm not going to pose a question. I'm going to give you an answer.
How does that
So if
fix
you look
that?
At how the contracts are awarded in St. Louis City specifically, you'll see that the unions and union-affiliated shops, or whatever you call it, I'm not the union guy, you are, 75% of those contracts go to those individuals. By having right to work, it gives more people the opportunity to access those contracts.
But why do they go to those individuals?
I'm sorry?
Is it right to work that stops it or prohibits, or is there a rule in the city on a local level that impacts who gets hired?
So actually, the way it works in the city, the mayor actually had to put out an executive order to get more minorities included in the way things work in St. Louis City. But then labor came back and just last week, and you know they want to put some more barriers there, so they want to require an apprenticeship program for contracts of $25,000 or more.
So how does right to work fix that?
It's not a comprehensive fix.
It's not a fix at all. That's what
so
I'm
what would you
at.
Do?
No, you're not asking me questions.
I'm asking
once again.
You. I just did.
This does not fix the issue. We can talk offline.
I understand
talking
what
about
you have to do. I get
you,
it.
Please don't go down that route, because there's people pulling strings and we're not going to
really?
Call those people out. So what we're doing, what
individual.
We're doing, that's what
I think for myself.
All right. So how does right to work fix the issue with the discrimination that may be within training, within bringing people in? How does right to work fix that?
It will cripple the monopoly that the building trades currently have over the industry.
So it'll cripple their segment of
they won't get money that they don't deserve because they are the sole collective bargaining agents for people that don't necessarily.
We're getting somewhere there. So it's going
to
cripple the building trades industry.
No, the unions. The building trades unions.
The building trades unions, which are part of all of organized labor, correct?
Sure.
I'm not in the building trade.
Okay. I get that.
Okay, so you understand. I use this example today, and I don't know what you said. I use this example today of you're coming at a part of essentially a family of individuals.
So typically in families, you know, you fight.
We do that all the time.
As Democrats, we fight for equality.
I'm not talking
and if
about
we're for
a
equality, then we hold
issue.
Everybody accountable to the same
so you're
equality.
Holding, so if
I'd
that's the
that
case, you should come after.
Hasn't done that. I'd
done?
Argue that the building trades
okay.
have been the most systematic inequality organization that we have in the labor industry.
Are they part
that's
of?
Wrong.
Are they part of overall organized labor? Yes or no?
If you're asking if they're a member of the AFL-CIO,
I'm asking
that they
is
are.
The building trade a part of organized labor?
Could you answer the question for me?
Is I'm asking you a question. You're not going to throw me off my
everything.
Game.
I don't know everything about labor. I'll admit
but
that.
You got a bill
that
impacts
that historically.
So you don't know the details
I know
of
that
your
this
bill?
Is for the building trades. I know that it's not for.
But
all
you
of
don't
labor.
Understand how it
if
impacts
you're
all of
that
organized
this will
labor.
Have a trickle down effect mm-hmm. for the other unions. That's a good marketing ploy.
Is it
what
true?
We're talking about is the issues that
no,
exist within
you keep
the building
talking.
Trades.
about whatever you want to talk about, and I'm going to keep restating the question, and we can do this all day long.
We can.
So it's a part of organized labor, correct?
Sure.
Okay.
So if I'm wrong, please correct me.
If you impact one part of organized labor, which is a family, don't you think you impact the other part?
The fact
if I cut off your left arm, isn't it going to
practices
cut
off? Of inequality for years, I think that they are affecting the other ones.
If I cut
the only
off
reason
your left
the other ones are in the room currently is because of the practices that they've deployed.
Okay.
So yes, it does affect.
But
just like
even,
if you affect my minorities, the community that I belong to, you know, you're going to affect the rest of us as well. That's why we should all be in this fight together.
Hard.
Some
it's hard.
On one side and some on another.
It's hard trying to get credibility out of you or a straight
really?
Answer. Because you don't know the facts, which is fine.
Please enlighten me.
I am. Quit talking.
Stop asking
Representative
questions.
Representative Smith,
no,
I might remind you, we have about 35 witnesses.
I understand.
Hour, so
but if the sponsor of the bill does not want to ask questions and talks about what he wants to talk about, to get away from the fact that
I would
his
like
bill
to get this
worthless.
Hearing conducted.
Okay, all right, so I've got a few more and then I'll wrap up. So what you don't seem to understand, and you can't get it because maybe the people who told you didn't tell you this part, is with organized labor, it's a whole. It's not perfect at all. I can take you to the historical standpoint where you had slaves that were free coming out of the South, and you had organized labor groups that were put together to put these slaves that had skill sets to keep them at bay. And in this same building, there was laws that were passed against people like me and you, yet we work here. We didn't shun the whole system of democracy because of that, did we? No, we did not. But you're trying to impact the whole system. True, there things aren't perfect there, but you've got an issue, or someone's got an issue in a certain area, and you're trying to use this bill to solve that issue, but it won't do anything.
I have the same issue that you should have.
No, it won't do anything. If you look at the statistics,
being a labor guy, then we could have gotten here.
If you actually go to Right to Work, you know whose union membership goes up?
Who?
Building trades.
Okay.
Look at Oklahoma. Look at all these states that switch. They go up, and you know who's impacted.
Why isn't that the case now?
It's all the other unions.
Tell me why that's not the case.
It's the other unions, such as the one I belong to, such as the United Food and Commercial Workers.
So you're not fighting against
the
inequality.
It's all the other unions that are represented and have high numbers of African Americans that are impacted.
And they haven't
so it would be foolish for me
as well,
to look past what you're attempting to do and not to think that it's going to impact
how else would you do it?
This part.
As a labor guy, how else would you do it?
You
We've
would
been
be
trying
foolish
for 20 plus years.
That. You would be foolish to think
Please
that.
Tell me how else you
but
do
But you're
it.
Okay with this. You're getting
I
a little shy.
I am definitely okay.
You've got people
it's
up there testifying.
It's not about shy. I haven't asked for a thing
You're
going to
get the support of the Republicans over here, and then the people are finally going to know your name for something.
Really?
For something.
Because they don't already know because of what I've done.
First, I don't know what you've done, but what I'm saying is your bill here that says construction industry impacts more than just what you consider building trades.
Inequality anywhere affects more than just the industry in which it takes
you
place.
You can go with quotes, you can do whatever
That's not
you
a quote,
do.
I just came up with that.
Well, we can look at gone beyond an inquiry. Yeah. I'd like for next question.
Hopefully he'll answer questions in the future. Thank you.
Representative Fraker.
To inquire, Mr. Chairman.
Go ahead.
Good afternoon, Representative.
Good afternoon.
You mentioned a word that we heard the other day in our hearing on Monday, and we heard last year. I've been on this committee. This will be my fifth year, and we hear it every year when this issue comes up. I'd like for you to elaborate just a little bit. You mentioned that a free rider program exists even now without Right to Work. Would you elaborate on that?
Sure. Essentially, an individual that's a member of labor would tell you that by going Right to Work, you know, individuals would benefit by not having to pay for the benefits that have been bargained for on their behalf. So, in ascension, essentially you get a free rider. What I'm saying is the free rider program exists in that what labor is not doing in terms of fighting for equality within the building trades, they are getting a free ride off of the diversity that's taking place in other unions without having to fix what's wrong in their house. So that's the free rider program. Minorities have, for the most part, supported unions, you know, to date, and they don't get the same return on investment for that support that, you know, some members within the building trades get. It's only about the building trades for me. It's about equality. It's about getting the same access to that return on investment. We don't get that, so and essentially you have the free rider program.
Your concern here is with building trades, but do you think these same issues, and you've used some pretty strong words, barriers, free rider, strong arm tactics, monopoly, do you think those issues exist beyond the building trades and the other
it's likely
the other businesses that have union membership?
It's likely. I didn't do thorough research to see what happened elsewhere. I know that this is a place, like I said, if you do a Google search, it's not a surprise, you know, that they have as many issues as they do. I'm not saying that, you know, that I expect them to be perfect. I expect them to be working towards it. And from the individuals I've talked to that I'm fighting on behalf of, they've been fighting this fight for more than 15 years.
Thank you.
Thank you,
Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, sirs. I'd like to now hear from some of those testifying against the bill. Representative Curtis, you can join us here if you wish. Mr. Claude Cummins, would you like to testify? I'd like to remind all the witnesses that we need to have the forms filled out, please. Go ahead when you're ready, sir.
Okay, good afternoon to everyone. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and all of those of you who are here today, all my labor friends in the back, especially my CWA members. I'm happy to be here today to speak against this bill. I represent members in Missouri, Texas, Oklahoma, Kansas, and Arkansas. About 50,000 union members over those five states. All of those states are right to work, with the exception of Missouri. I serve on the CWA National Executive Board, representing 500,000 plus workers across this country. I also serve on the Coalition of Black Trade Unionists Board, representing thousands of workers in this country. I serve on the Executive Board of the A. Philip Randolph Institute, representing thousands of workers in this country. I also serve as a member of the Coalition of Labor Union Women, representing women and other workers around this country. And I'm also the vice president of the NAACP in Houston, Texas. Now, I talk to you and give you all of that information because I want you to know that I'm well-versed on right to work. So I'm not just here with someone that's been given a speech just to talk about it. I've lived it. I know about it, and I know what it can do to workers in the state. Representative Curtis talked about this being Black History Month, so why don't we just see what Dr. King had to say about right to work. Dr. King in 1961 said, "In our glorious fight for civil rights, we must guard against being fooled by false slogans such as right to work. It is a law to rob us of our civil rights and our job rights. Its purpose is to destroy labor unions and freedom of collective bargaining by which unions have improved wages and working conditions of everybody. Wherever these laws have passed, wages are lower, job opportunities are fewer, and there are no civil rights." He also goes on to say, "We do not intend to let them do this to us. We demand this fraud be stopped. Our weapon is our vote." So again, since it's Black History Month, let's talk about what the NAACP has to say, the leading organization for civil rights in this country. This resolution was passed in 2013. "Whereas the NAACP has passed numerous resolutions advocating on behalf of worker rights for over 60 years, therefore, be it resolved that the NAACP advocates for the repeal of all so-called right-to-work laws that have been enacted and opposed, all that are being considered by a local, state, or federal legislature. And be it further resolved that the NAACP reiterates its strong support for all workers to collectively bargain for their wages, benefits, working conditions, and other rights. And be it finally resolved that the NAACP, recognizing that workers' rights are civil rights, is committed to working in coordination with other like-minded individuals organizations, and groups which may be opposed to so-called right-to-work laws, either through political, legal, or other advocacy means. Now, that's what one of the leading civil rights persons had to say, in Dr. King, and also the NAACP, the civil rights the largest civil rights organization in this country. So I sit before you today understanding clearly that there is work to be done between the building trades and the African-American community to make sure there is more opportunities for work in the building trades on construction projects. However, a right to work law will not do that. I'm also sure Representative Corden's bill, 582, is filed to try and bring more attention to the fact that more, not less, needs to be done to ensure more participation of African-American and other minorities in construction work in Missouri. But a right-to-work bill would not do that. The bill as filed advocates the building trades unions. However, all in this hearing must understand clearly that in the labor movement, we have a motto that is true: an injury to one is an injury to all. This bill, in the end, will adversely affect all working people and will lead to lower wages and drive down the overall living standards in communities. And as Dr. King said so eloquently, all unions will come together to stop it. So I will make a few points and go back to my seat. First of all, a right-to-work bill will not ensure more work to minority contractors or anyone else. It will not give minority contractors any advantage, but it will bring in large out-of-state construction companies that have no investment in Missouri, and will also bring their low-wage earners with them. It will also hurt state workers and hurt the communities they serve with poor service. Number two, the facts are, in right-to-work states, construction workers have a much higher level of workplace injury and fatalities, and again, much lower average wages than Missouri workers. Number three, in other right-to-work states, minority contractors still have to fight for a fair share of federal or private contracts, so right-to-work will not help with that problem that's here. Number four, the labor movement is the largest provider of construction and other skills training in this country other than the U.S. military. Without organized building trades or other unions, Missouri contractors' ability to find skilled trade workers will be devastated. However, large contractors that have been waiting for years at your borders for right to work to pass will crowd the state with low skill and cheap labor wage earners. Number five, right to work laws will hurt workers in every union and every race and every gender in this state. Finally, I understand clearly, very clearly, that there is work to be done to include more minority workers in all industries, not just the building trades. However, right to work won't be good for any of Missouri's workers or its small minority businesses or any other industry. All it will do is take away workers' voices, reduce income of families, destroy communities, lower the standard of living, ensure there will be more injuries due to poor training, and hurt small minority businesses. It will destroy the middle class in Missouri. Right to work is not good for Missouri. It is not good for the workers in Missouri. Thank you. One other thing I will say, I'm one of the largest employers in this state. AT&T has gone on record as opposing right to work. So I want to make sure that you all know that too. And one other comment I'll say, when you have an issue like this, you don't throw out the baby with the wash. You sit down, cool heads need to talk through it. I understand clearly, again, there's an issue with the building trades in the African-American community, but right to work is not going to fix it. We need people with cool heads to sit down in a meeting and work through it. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Representative Hoskins.
Permission.
Go ahead.
Thank I don't think my microphone's working, so we'll just...
Here we go. Thank you for testimony, gentlemen. I had just two questions. What percentage of the building trade unions in Missouri are minority?
I don't know. I don't have a clue, and to be quite honest with you, that's not that important to me. You know, that's for them to work out. You know, the problem is, whatever the percentage is, a right to work law is not going to fix it.
Okay, well, I see you said you don't know and you don't care, right. But you've also just get some testimony that you said there should be more minority owned businesses and more minority opportunities. So
that's correct.
It's kind of, I don't care, but I want it. So it's kind of two different things. And then,
but if I may explain, what I'm saying is I don't care about the numbers, because the numbers is not going to fix the right to work. If right to work is not going to fix the numbers, period. Regardless of what the numbers are,
okay.
Right to work is not.
Well, then I guess it just means that your testimony where you talked about that didn't apply to this right to work anyway. So I'm not quite for sure then why you would bring it up if you want to talk about it now. And then the second thing question I had is, you mentioned that right to work violates civil rights. Would you elaborate that a little bit to me? I'd like to hear your thoughts.
Sure. Well, what right to work will do is it will not afford the opportunity to have, for minorities to have a voice on the job. Right now, in many states where there are not unions, minorities do not have a voice on the job. Their civil rights, their equal rights, their wage rights are being violated. Having a strong, closed shop state makes sure that there's equality when it comes to working conditions, it makes sure there's equality when it comes to wages, it makes sure there's equality when it comes to working conditions and civil rights.
Well, I guess I'd have to disagree with you.
That's fine.
We have some strong minority state reps and state senators here, and I put them up with, you know, non-minority state reps and state senators. So
yeah, well, I will take you back to the statement I said initially. I'm not just from Missouri. I represent four other states that are right to work, and I know what happens in those states. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you for your testimony. The representative that offered this bill, he and I were elected at the same time, and we're both sophomores in the legislature. And I know him to be very sincere and very dedicated to try to work to make his district better, as I am to try to make my district better. You said that this was not a solution to the problems that he's trying to address. Then what are the solutions to the problems that he's trying to address?
Well, I think that they need to sit down in a room and work through it. Simple as that. And I don't know that that's been done. I'm not talking about in this room. I'm talking about outside this room. You know, this fight between the building trades and the African American community or a minority contractors, that fight shouldn't be held here. That discussion needs to be held outside this room. You don't destroy all workers because one segment of labor's got a problem with the community. That's not what Dr. King meant when he made that statement. That's not how communities work through issues. We don't try to hurt people in the community. You don't try to destroy the middle class. You sit in a room and you try to work through those issues. This is ridiculous. I can't ever remember a time in my life when you had labor and the African-American community that couldn't work through an issue like this. This is ridiculous. I've been involved in the labor movement for over 40 years. And this is absolutely ridiculous that you have two segments of the community that have worked so strongly together over the years, that came together when Dr. King marched on Washington, D.C. and other places. Those two communities worked together. They didn't work against each other like what's taking place in here today. There needs to be cooler heads to get in a meeting somewhere and work through it. And I believe if that's done, because believe me, there are a lot of people that look like me in positions with authority and influence. And if we could all sit down in a room together, different unions with the community and the building trades, I truly believe we can work through it. But one thing I know for sure, a right to work bill is not going to fix it. It's going to hurt other unions. And it's going to hurt the state of Missouri. You got Republican legislators here, Democratic legislators here. It ain't a Republican legislative issue or a Democratic legislative issue. It's a Missouri issue. And it's going to hurt the state, it's going to hurt the standard of living, it's going to destroy the middle class, it's going to destroy communities if right to work is passed. and again, take it from someone who represents four states that are right to work. And I know what I have to fight for every day in those states, and it's not easy.
Okay. Now, do you say there's no discrimination between the minority population and the building trades unions? Is there discrimination being done now, you think? I mean, that's what the representative indicates. So if there is discrimination, why would you want to support that?
Let me say this again. No one is going to pull me into a fight against the building trades and the African-American community. What I'm telling you is I understand clearly. I don't live in Missouri. You guys do. I understand, though, that there's an issue between those two communities. I'm here strictly to talk about right to work and the impact that it can have on the community, the middle class, all working people in all segments of society in the state of Missouri. It will hurt everybody if a right to work bill is passed. The fight that those two groups are having, they need to sit down again and try to work that out. And as I stated in my last statement, throwing the baby out with the wash by making this a right to work bill, a state, is not going to fix the issue. It is not. As a matter of fact, it will make it worse, because as I stated earlier, on the borders of Missouri, I guarantee you, you've got large contractors that have no investment in Missouri that are going to bring in low-wage workers to do that work. Do you think that they're going to give work to minority contractors here? I can tell you, they ain't. It ain't going to happen.
So this is a little bit bigger issue than just St. Louis or Missouri. This is kind of a national issue.
I'm not saying that, because I haven't been called to talk from anywhere else.
I mean, that's kind of what you just said, or the way I understood it. But anyway, I appreciate your testimony, and hopefully, just how could you get everybody together in a room outside here? Because we brought everybody in here today, and that's a good beginning.
Well, you know, I just think it's a meeting should have been held in some form before. Why that hasn't happened, I don't have a clue. Okay, to be quite honest with you, I don't.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Representative Burns, and I want to remind you guys all again. I have no objection to anyone asking questions, but please ask a question and let it be answered. We've got 35 people to testify before we leave here today.
Okay, but I was just going to say, I don't know that people haven't tried to meet, but if they have, it didn't come any good. And I know the right to work is not going to fix what the issue is.
Mr. Chairman, will you also please exercise that authority of people who aren't testifying to keep them on track? Appreciate it. Permission to inquire. Thank you for being here, and I'm aware of the work that your union does, and I realize that your union is not under an apprentice program or training, just like my union, the Teamsters, is not.
Right.
You're trained by your fellow workers or schooling that the companies or may send you to. What did you say the number of people that you represent, that your union represents?
I represent in this part of the country over 50,000.
50,000. Yes. Totally the CWA, what would you say?
Close to 700,000.
700,000. How many minorities are in your union? Do you have any idea?
Not off the top of my head, but quite a few.
Quite a few.
Yes, sir, quite a few.
I'll be anxious.
As a matter of fact, you work through the call centers here, I think you see a good representation of African Americans.
Well, that's the point is, and I'm not sure the minority community percentage in the United States, but I would assume that your percentage is probably larger than that percentage.
That's correct.
Okay. The other issue is, in the building, I'd be anxious to hear the building trades, particularly in our state, how many minorities are involved? How many minorities have been through the apprentice programs? In this, as you said, minorities rise up in places of leadership, just like you.
Right.
Now, when you do that, you're elected by your fellow union members, or women are men union members, is that not true?
That's correct.
Okay, so you have to be there all the time, they know you're conscientious, you get elected to your position.
That's correct.
And if you don't do a job that's good for these members of 50,000 that you represent, you get voted out of office.
That's
just
correct.
Like one of us up here.
That's correct.
Based, right? The other issue is, there were some things brought up about strong arm tactics. I know your union doesn't use that.
No.
My union doesn't use that because it's against federal law.
That's correct.
The other issue is, there was, something was brought up about, it was published that on a certain building project or a project that they were not going to use minorities in the first round. That's against the law. Is that not true?
Discrimination.
That's discrimination against the law, the Civil Rights Act of 1965.
Right.
Is that not true?
That's correct.
So who is going to violate your union, my union? Certainly not, particularly after we had three federal judges over our union, appointed by the first George Bush. Since the 80s, we got a clean bill of health. They've been there. No findings, and now we got the clean bill of health. Nobody's going to violate federal law, because you know if you do, you're going to be hauled into federal court and some union official is going to go to jail.
That's correct.
That true?
That's true.
Thank you very much for being here. I don't have any more
questions. One other thing, if I might say, the majority of delegates that voted for me were white when I was elected to this position.
Representative Dorman.
To inquire, Mr. Chairman.
Go ahead.
Thank you. Thank you. Did I correctly hear you say, and tell me if I'm wrong, but I believe you made the statement that right to work would destroy the middle class?
Yes, sir, I do believe that.
And what states do you represent?
Texas, Arkansas, Kansas, and Oklahoma.
Okay. I was just looking at a chart here, per capita income in a five-year period, up in Oklahoma, in Arkansas, about $5,000. Missouri, it was about $3,500 at the same time. Missouri is not a right-to-work state, correct?
That's correct.
I just wanted to point that out.
Yeah, and you can, you. You can point that
Thank
out.
Thank you very much. Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
All right. I mean, I don't know your point, because you'd have to look at the demographics of those workers, too, to see how much they're getting paid. So.
Just to clarify, you made a broad generalized statement that one piece of legislation was going to destroy the middle class. And I've heard that, I've heard it. First of all, what is the middle class? Is the middle class today what it was 70 years ago? Those sorts of things. My point is, we can generalize all day long. That doesn't necessarily mean that it's supported by facts.
Yeah. Well, we'll disagree on that, because what I can tell you is that I believe the standard of living for workers in this country 25 and 30 years ago was larger, because there were
you're
a high percentage
that,
of you're workers.
That opinion.
Right. And that's what I understand that. But I also lived it, because I've been involved in this for over 40 years. You're not going to tell me, with the private sector being organized, it's only 6%, the public sector at 11%, that the middle class is better off now than it was 30 years ago, when it was over 30% organized.
And that's all due to right to work?
Yes.
All due to right to
yes.
work? Can you prove
yes.
it?
Yes. No, I can't prove that now, because I'm not here to talk about that. But I tell you what, I'll come back and I'll prove it and sit down and talk with you about it. I bring the facts.
I think there are a lot of factors that feed into that.
All right.
Representative Gosin.
Gentlemen, a couple of times you mentioned this hearing being ridiculous. You know, when I have a friend and a colleague bring a bill up here on an issue that I've invited people into my office the last 36 hours, maybe people in this room, to explain and try to understand this issue better to me, because I don't understand the labor issue real well. I've worked very hard, and this friend and colleague of mine has a concern. To me, that's not ridiculous at all. It's very important. It's something we need to deal with. Why do you think it's ridiculous?
Okay, so I didn't say that this hearing was ridiculous. So let's make sure
this bill is not.
No, that's not what I said. What I said was, it's ridiculous that we have to come here to have this type of fight, that it should have been held before we got here. That was my point. You know, I did not say anything was ridiculous about this. This is the way things work. They work in other states. I've testified in other states before. No, it's not ridiculous.
He said he's tried to talk to people and no one would talk to him, so maybe this isn't that ridiculous.
Well, I don't think
this is ridiculous at all. Thank you.
Yeah. Well, I didn't say this hearing was ridiculous. What I said was, it's ridiculous that the issue couldn't be worked out before we got here. So I can clarify that for the record, okay? All right.
Thank you very much, sir.
Okay. Thank you so very much.
Reverend, is it Polito? Ladies and gentlemen, please try to keep your testimony and your questions very short. If we spend 3 minutes each, we'll be here for another hour and a half.
Thank you. I'm Reverend Rudy Polito. I'm a retired clergy person. Clergy do not have unions, but we have a marvelous retirement program after life. I want you to know that. I do want to say that, having read the bill, I was totally surprised this morning that the bill had anything to do with inequality. The wording of the bill speaks directly to the issue of right to work. I serve on the St. Louis Interfaith Partnership Cabinet, and last year the Cabinet took a strong statement out opposing right-to-work legislation in our state. I visited with pastors throughout the state and, among other things, asked them about right-to-work. Many of them were for it until they understood what it was really all about. For pastors and church leaders, right-to-work is kind of like having to read the fine print on a contract. And we neglect the fine print at our own peril. The fine print of right to work contains devastating consequences, among them being issues of social justice. But in fact, right to work leads to diminished wages. Should Missouri become a right to work state, then churches need to begin planning for diminished gifts from church members. Now, it may not happen immediately. Be sure it will not happen immediately, but it will happen ultimately. And this will be especially challenging for many churches located in the rural parts of our state, where wages received by organized laborers and other parts of the state prop up the wages that are earned in those other areas of our state. As we hope for our children, we also hope for our churches. We hope for a better and more opportune tomorrow. If Missouri becomes a right-to-work state, our children and our churches both lose. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, sir. Representative Brandon.
Yeah, to inquire.
Sure. Yeah.
You know, as a churchgoer and a Christian, you know, God requires us each to pay tithe to Him, a 10% of our income. Did your church require 10% to be paid membership to the church?
No, but we required something be given to the church.
So when the offering plate went by a church, you required somebody to drop some sort of money into the plate?
Not necessarily, because there were some people who couldn't, but most did.
So would they be freeloading on the church then?
I would have to say we do have freeloaders. Every church has freeloaders, but they are sustained by those who can give.
Right. So everybody is lifted up by the contribution of everybody.
Exactly.
Okay.
But if no one contributes, then no church has a future. No church, whether in the metropolitan area or rural Missouri, has a future.
Right. But to that individual, it's within their heart and their giving spirit to give to the church as they feel led, correct? It shouldn't be a mandate.
There is a church covenant that most churches possess. And I'm not quite sure if you're a Baptist. I'm a Baptist. But Baptists have a church covenant, which reads in the church covenant that we will sustain the church. And that's given. That's a given fact. But many people don't uphold that. But we require, you know, we would ask people to do that. Yes.
Right. But you see, the people have that freedom, and they have to answer for that. But they have that freedom to belong to the church, regardless of their giving of their funds or whatnot. I guess I look at that in the same way of a right to work. You know, I'm still working within that field. I'm still providing the service and putting in the sweat of my brow, still earning a wage. But I'm required to pay into something. And as a church member, you know, over $400 million was given politically by unions, that over 80% of that, you know, funded Democrat members that go against what the church believes.
Now,
so I guess you know, you're coming here and speaking for against right to work when forced unionization and the money coming from unions is going against that what the church preaches and what the gospel preaches. I guess I'm perplexed.
Well, that's one aspect of what the gospel preaches. The other aspect is of fairness, rightness, morality,
and
social
justice. But God's moral law comes before, you know, kind of a fairness. God's absolutes comes before that. So I guess what you're coming for the latter part versus the absolutes of doctrine. I guess I'm, as a believer, I'm appalled.
So, thank you.
Okay.
Thank you, sir. I have to admit, that's a little different for a right to work hearing. I'd like to hear from Jay Atkins now.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. It's a pleasure to be before this group again. My name is Jay Atkins. I am a registered lobbyist and general counsel for the Missouri State Chamber of Commerce and Industry. Happy to be here for the second time this week. And in the interest of brevity, I know we have a lot of witnesses to get to. For those of you that heard my testimony on Monday, I will incorporate that by reference at this time. I don't have a lot more to add other than this is a something of a new twist on a issue that's been around for a while. I do applaud Representative Curtis for bringing this bill forward and having his voice heard. Chamber is happy to support his bill, and it's been our longstanding position that right to work is the best way to move forward for the state of Missouri, and we hope that this committee takes this important first step. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Happy to answer your question.
Thank you, sir. Demetrius Johnson, please.
Mr. Chairman, mind if I go with him, please?
That'd be fine.
Okay, thanks. Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman, members of this august body. My name is Bruce W. Holt. I'm a registered lobbyist in the state of Missouri for the Painters District Council 58 in St. Louis, and District Council 3 in Kansas City. I come here today to let you know one thing. My union is a little bit different than other unions. I was a policy advisor for Governor Blunt. I was chief of staff for State Senator Scott Rubin. And I had retired when I went to work for Governor Blunt, but they called me out of retirement to come to work. When I was hired 3 years ago, at that time, our vice president, nationally, an African-American gentleman, was elected to the presidency of this union, Mr. Ken Rigmaiden, longtime member of the union. While he was vice president, he was working on a program called CORE, Community Organizing for Real Economics. He realized, as we all do, that the Painters Union, like some other unions, woefully underemployed minorities in the field. We were at less than 5%. After 3 years of working toward a program that would give young men and women the opportunity to come in and for 14 weeks with no pay from 6:30 to 3:30 p.m. daily with three absences. At the end of this program, we have had contractor meetings right already with our Painting and Decorating Foundation. The contractors are chomping at the bit to interview these kids at the end of this program to employ them. You can make minority set-asides 45%, 50%, but if you can't meet them, it's a moot point. We want to be the one union that says, you need people, we got them. And with that, we partnered with the Demetrius Johnson Charitable Foundation, and I would like to say the impact on our union would be, if you have people who are not paying dues, every person right now working pays 59 cents an hour out of their check. That goes to the education fund. Last year, the painters spent $1.6 million on educating our members. When these young men and women get out of our program, they will have their OSHA card, they will have CPR, they will have some first aid, and they will have their lead card. And they will also have either a GED, a high school diploma, they will clean test positive or negative for drugs to stay in, because we do have frequent tests. If they test positive, they're immediately out of the program. And they will have to have their driver's license. We want to give them the best possible start we can. And with that, if you don't mind, I'll turn it over to Mr. Johnson.
Good evening, Mr. Chair and the committee. My name is Demetrius Johnson. I'm a resident of St. Louis, Missouri. Grew up in the Dawes Webby Housing Projects. Attended the University of Missouri Columbia, where I played football. I was drafted by the Detroit Lions, where I played there for years. I'm now a national sales manager for Covidian in St. Louis. The program that I'm here to speak about, I'm gonna make this clear. I mean, if any of you know me or know of me, I'm very blunt and candid about what I'm here for. I'm not here to represent Democrats or Republicans. the parties. I'm here to represent the young black men and the young black boys in the street of St. Louis. When you look at all the issues that we have going on in our community in St. Louis, it's devastating. I have kids, and anything can happen to my kids, just like it is. I mean, we're not immune from the tragedies that's going on in the street. My foundation being able to partner with the District Council 58 Painters Union is just tremendous. You're gonna hear from two young men that's here, both of these guys from the street. See, they're out there in the grind. They're out there in the war zone. A lot of times when I play in the NFL, the thing that keeps me so, I guess, in tune with the community, we give away 3,000 turkeys every year. We go and raise the money. We don't get union money. We don't get federal state money. We get money from friends in the community that I go out there and do these things for. But what keeps me level-headed is because when I go into these communities, we take the baskets to the door of the homes. And it keeps us real and get us understanding that there are folks in a community who is truly suffering, who truly don't have anything to hope for. Sometimes when you're up in this community or here, this political, I'm not used to the political arena that I'm in today, but I'm gonna tell you something. Sometimes you can be in this arena and forget about the true arena. That's the constituents out there in the street who's going through all these problems. The tragedies that these young men and women are facing in my community, I can't speak of no one else's community. I can speak of mine. I don't have to do what I do in that community. When I woke up this morning, put on my clothes and got in the car, drove up here, you know what I was thinking? I had a great life. Life has been good to me. My kids are in college, kids out of college, have a great job. I don't need to ask anyone of you for nothing up here. That makes me feel good because it's independence. But when I hear this situation, I'm just here to talk about the program, the Council 58, District Council, what they're doing for these young men. It's a 14-week program. It's a five days a week program. They are there at 6:30 in the morning. They do not leave until 3:30 in the afternoon, and they don't get a dime. But we always want to talk about our young black youth are lazy. They don't want to do anything for themselves. They don't want no chances out in the street. But let me tell you something. You got folks down there that's there at 6 o'clock every morning. And they don't leave until 4:30 every day. And they don't get paid a dime. I guarantee you none of you will be here at 6 o'clock in the morning. You wouldn't even pay. Guarantee you that. But I'm telling you, we got some young folks that want to do that.
Johnson, we're under some real time constraints.
Yes, sir. I just need to let you, yes, sir, Chairman. I just need everybody to understand the program that the District Council 58 has allowed these young men to take part in is tremendous. You don't have to worry about these young men anymore on the street doing nothing, because they're going to do their best to take care of their family. They want the same dream that every one of you up here want and everyone in the back. Safe, equitable, fairness, and an opportunity to provide for their family. Thank you, Mr. Chair and the committee.
Thank you, sir. I can allow 3 minutes each from this point forward, ladies and gentlemen.
Understandable. How you doing, Mr. Chairman and the committee? My name is Ronaldo Ward, 33 of age. I'll be brief about myself. Used to be out in the streets. I only made it through my third year in high school. Do not have my high school diploma or my GED. Didn't really think that I needed one for anything. Basically, try to take care of my family any way that I could for it in the streets. My daughter is 16 of age. I have 5 kids. My youngest is 5. I say this to say that I knew nothing about the union. I wasn't taught about this in school. My mother, father never brought anything to me, no uncles or nobody that's in this field. Just basically thought it was a government job. You know, you get paid more than McDonald's. Don't feel like McDonald's, Wendy's is a good job for anyone. You know, have to deal with attitudes, or you know, it's not a skill in flipping burgers. I basically say this to say that now I'm married. I've been married for 6 years. I've been with my wife for 7. I have never changed a tire in my life. I'm 33 years old. Have not did anything with my hands, anybody asked me to do anything, I don't think I would have done. What I have learned now with the painters union is how to get up early in the morning, knowing that I need to get there, knowing that if I go to this this training, that I'm getting a skill to learn how to paint, how to build, that I could teach also to my kids, something that someone can take away from me. Discipline. The 15 young men that we have in this program right now, I never knew, never met. If I walk past them in the streets, private arguments, fights, stuff like that, that I'm used to in the streets. And right now, these 15 men, we're talking to each other, we're understanding how to pick up each other to make sure they get there on time, that we'll make it past this program for these 14 weeks to help out another 15 African Americans. A 401k. I never think that I have anything, a pension, anything like that. All I know that this is not just a job, that it's a career. And if any questions, anything, that's all I have to say.
Thank you, sir.
We have one more gentleman.
Okay.
Thank you, Mr.
Chair. Very briefly, please.
Yes, sir.
Hey, how y'all doing? My name is Frankie Edwards. I'm 25 years old. I'm from North St. Louis. I know a few of y'all who be down there in the city. I'm one of the bad kids around the neighborhood, but not no more. What I feel about the program is it's teaching me the skills and everything and the training that I need to know where I can get inside the union, get a good paying job and everything. Hands-on, I had a problem with school with reading and all that, and I needed hands-on training one-on-one, and I feel that the program is giving me all the things I need with dealing with painter and all the little tactics and all that. What I want to say about me growing up in a community where you just down on luck, you feel like there's no opportunity out there for you. I was selling drugs, I was locked up, I played with guns, stolen cars, I did the whole nine and everything. But dealing with Demetrius Charitable Foundation, when he talked to me about the program, it opened my eyes. And I got two kids, two boys and everything. I want the best for my kids, even if I can't enjoy the things that I'm working for. I want my kids to enjoy them. So I salute the Painters Union Council 58 and Demetrius Johnson, and also the other people inside the community that are helping us, because this program, it will stop a lot of things, if you believe it or not. And I'm speaking on behalf of the people my age and the generation, for us to get inside and get these opportunities, get the opportunities that everybody else is getting. Say, like, dealing with this program, they see me working in the program and they see the other 14 gentlemen inside the program. They're like, dang, so you was going to school for free, doing all that training, now you getting paid, now you got this and that. Now they gonna wanna join the same program and get the same things I want. I feel it'll lessen crime and tighten up things. So just a brief, I'm new to this.
Thank you, Mr. Johnson, Mr. Edwards, Mr.
Thank
Ward,
you.
Appreciate you. Mr. Hodges, could we hear from you, please? Mr. Les Williams, Jr., are you here?
Good afternoon. My name is Les Williams, Jr. I'm Vice President of the Laborers Union 264 of Kansas City, Missouri. I've been a laborer for 27 years. I'm 46 years old right now. I was a young kid at the Right to Work that was in 1978. My dad, he was a business manager. He's been in construction for 47 years. He was business manager for my local for 15 years. And my mom, she was also a machinist. And one thing I can say about Right to Work is a bad deal. The title is very misleading. It lets people think that, okay, I can get a job, I don't have to do anything, I'm just here for a handout. This bill is not a right to work bill. It's a lower your standards so I can participate bill. You said you don't see anybody like you that look like you in this position. Here you are. This is me. I've been in construction, like I said, for 27 years. I'm on the job sites every day. Not every once in a while, and not just driving by. I'm there. I see minorities there. They're working, the minorities that want to work. There's a lot of minorities that don't want to work. There was one time there where there was a rally, and minorities was rallying against our parade, Labor Day parade. And at that time, I was just getting in the office. I was an organizer at the time, and I gave out eight minorities my card. Told them, give me a call, get in a week, and I'm going to try to get you someplace, put you in a job. Out of those eight people, three didn't show up, never called. The four that did, couldn't pass drug tests. And the one guy that went through the whole process didn't show up on Monday morning. Those are all but minorities. I believe, in my opinion, this fight is not a right to work fight. It's a lawyer, like I said, it's a lower your standards so we can participate. If we keep lowering the bar, what do we have? We're supposed to be the number one country. If we keep lowering standards, we're not going to be number one country. I think we should take our money, and like the guy said, this is not the arena for it. I think there's places that we can sit down and talk about minorities and job placement. And no, everything is not perfect. You can go to a Fortune 500 company and see the same thing. You can see the same nepotism there too. I believe that work ethic starts at home, starts with family, starts with mom and dad. I'm a single father of four. My oldest son will be graduating from college, and I'm still raising three more. And I'm going to tell you right now, I cannot do it at $10 an hour. I can't. What you're going to do with that right to work for our community, it's going to tear us down. I live in the community. My next door neighbors are union guys. Without the union, and you want to know where the middle class went when we passed the NAFTA, right to work, that's where our middle class went. I'm the last of a dying breed, which is middle class.
I hate to cut you short, sir, but we are running out of time.
Okay, and I failed to mention that I'm a fourth generation laborer, so it's not about keeping us out. Sometimes it is, but the most time, it's about picking ourselves up and doing something about it, like these two group of men behind me spoke earlier. Thank you. Any questions?
Thank you very much. Rachel Payton, could I hear from you, please? I'd like to hear from Rachel Payton, please.
Hi, I'm Rachel Payton, Deputy State Director with Americans for Prosperity, Missouri, and on behalf of our 67,000 activists in all 114 counties in Missouri, we support this piece of legislation.
Thank you very much. Martine Rafana, is that correct? Ronnie Griffin.
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, my name is Ronnie Griffin. I'm the Vice President and Business Agent of Laborers Local 110 in St. Louis County. I'm a 36-year union member, 32 years of which I was an active worker in the field. I sit before you today about House Bill 582, Right to Work. As a 36-year member, 32 of which is spent working, I can attest to what membership a strong union does for me. I began working as a union in a union straight out of high school. Graduating and looking to join a union, I had every opportunity that anybody had to get in a union at the time. I graduated high school in Berkeley in the representative's district. I also own property in his district yet today. I began working almost immediately after high school. Now, when I got into labor 36 years ago, apprenticeship wasn't what it is today. Today, in our apprenticeship program, all a candidate needs is a letter of intent from a signatory contractor to enter into our apprenticeship program. Once he acquires that, the candidate can actually learn and earn at the same time. There are no fees or anything. He goes through approximately 2 years of apprenticeship. Once he graduates that apprenticeship program, he becomes a journeyman and he gets journeyman's pay. So we make it fairly easy to get in. All you need to do is solicit contractors. And if there's contractors out there looking for minorities to go to work, they will find them. Our apprenticeship has grown to be one of the best in the country. And it is now mandatory for all new members to become apprentices. This way we get the best trained workforce and sustainability. Because if you have the training when you go out on the job site, the more likelihood it is that they will retain you. And our goal, at least mine is as a representative of some 2,500 members, is to see those people working in this industry for years to come, same as me. Right to Work goes to the heart of the very structure and the power of the organization that has helped me live the life that I have and support that I have for my family. I am a minority, just like many of our members. We represent African Americans, Hispanics, Bosnians, Asians, whites, and more. We also represent both male and female. We are proud of diverse membership and proud that everyone that is a member of the laborers make the same wages for the same scope of work they are performing for one of our many signatory contractors. Right to Work threatens the very strength of our organization, and it threatens to undermine the pay, safety, benefits, brotherhood that we currently have. All we need to do is to study Right to Work in states and answer the questions that are clear. Wages are lower, workplace injuries and deaths are higher, benefits are less, and union membership is lower. Right to Work also diminishes our ability to recruit new members, especially minorities. Because Right to Work diminishes the resources and memberships of labor unions, the union bargains from a weaker position with fewer resources. Our abilities to participate in various programs aimed at minority recruitment could be hampered. We currently participate in a program called BUD, it's called Building Union Diversity. We graduated the first class, I believe, by the end of 2014.
I hate to cut you short, sir, but we're running out of time.
Yes, sir, I appreciate that. We also have a Latino outreach, and I am also a Board of Education member of the Construction Career Center in the city of St. Louis, grades 9 through 12, where we put the students through the construction program, and hopefully when they graduate as seniors, that we can put them to work. Right to Work, by eliminating union security costs, unfairly allows non-members that are part of the bargaining unit to receive the same benefits, training, work rules, and wages that dues-paying members have. Now, I have heard some say that Right to Work makes unions stronger. It couldn't be further from the truth. Let's make no mistake.
Sir, thank you very much, but we have to move on.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Holmes, please. I'll entertain questions, sir, if you would like to come show me which of these names you would like me to call.
Well, it was the one before this, but I'll forego that and I'll let you know at this time.
Go ahead with your testimony, sir.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, committee members, my name is Scott Ramshaw. I'm with the Plumbers and Pipers out of St. Louis. I'm the registered lobbyist. With me today is one of our retired members, David Holmes. But I just want to go on record that we're against House Bill 582. So with that, I'll turn it over to Dave.
Good afternoon, everybody. My work career started after I was discharged from the service, more or less, into a real job world. I was hired at United Barge Service. I worked there for 6 years. I was a shop steward there. and they had openings for minorities to come into the apprentice program. And I came in through the Urban League. And I started my apprenticeship in 1972. I completed my apprenticeship, and from there, I worked as a journeyman up until my retirement. I spent my last 6 years working as a lobbyist for the plumbers and pipers, which has really has opened up my eyes for a lot of things for the minority community out there. It gives me the, someone said, what you're probably here today is that, yeah, it afforded my family a good living. That's correct. But in order to make that good living, I had to apply myself. I had to learn how to work as a pipe fitter. And in turn, my son had the opportunity to come in as an apprentice. He went to Rankin for 2 years. He went to the apprentice program. He's working now as a journeyman pipe fitter. It's just, you know, the union job has a lot of fairness to it. People have fought for years for the right to join a union, and now we want to try to tear it down. That is wrong. That's just wrong. Nurses, teachers, pilots, etc. want unions. They get it. It's a fairness, a part of the union. I'm sitting here, I'm just really a look how someone can introduce a bill like this when it really hurts the whole state of Missouri. Yes, this job has afforded me the opportunity to educate my children and live comfortably. But we are a self-sufficient union. We are. So no one give us anything. We work for everything we get. However, union wages have allowed me to be a part of the American dream. The right to work, the right to work for less. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Jeremy and Katie.
Thank you, Chairman and Committee. Jeremy Katie with Missouri Alliance for Freedom, to say that we do support this bill. And with that.
Thank you, Jeremy. Mr. Mark Esther.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman, committee. My name is Mark Esters. I live in St. Louis County. I am president of the Coalition of Black Trade Unionists, the St. Louis chapter. And I am also lead organizer with Communication Workers of America Local 6355. CBTU and its vast membership of auto workers, food service workers, state workers, private sector workers, as well as skilled trades, and building and construction trade, oppose right-to-work legislation in any form or legislative language. CBTU is a national organization that's made up of union members from different sectors across the nation. We oppose this legislation because it goes against the rights of collective bargaining. And what I mean by that is that workers have the opportunity to collectively organize in their community and around their employment. We depend on this because unions are the bedrock to building a sustainable middle class in our communities. Minority union members have better wages and benefits that help sustain good living conditions for their children. CBTU members are union activists who support quality public education, good jobs, and are engaged in the political process by voting more often than any other members in the community. CBTU is against and opposed House Bill 582.
Thank you very much, sir. Representative Smith, you are recognized for a question.
Thank you. isn't just one.
Okay, I'll make it a multi-part question. I'm trying to figure out how to do this. Were you contacted by the sponsor of this bill to get your input beforehand? Because I was not, and he knew I was a union member because he said it. So that's my question.
No, I was never contacted by the sponsor of this bill beforehand, nor had any knowledge that the sponsor of this bill was going to write this language.
Okay, thank you, because it seems like Republicans that would be supportive of this bill were, but other people weren't. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Representative Smith. And thank you, sir. Mr. Brandt, would you like to testify, please? Have a Cedric Brandt, Marvin Sander.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and the committee. My name is Marvin Sanders. I am a member of the Carpenters District Council of the Greater St. Louis area. I'm an executive board member, Mr. Curtis, and I guess I do look like you. We cover all of the state of Missouri, all the state of Kansas, and about a third of the state of Illinois. I was brought on to the Carpenters District Council. Well, let me back up. It's important for this committee to know that I started out, I'm a 35-year member, I started out as a carpenter apprentice, moved all the way through the apprenticeship program, later ran major projects throughout the St. Louis area as a foreman, as superintendent, and so forth. Later came into the apprenticeship program as an instructor, went through the apprenticeship, training program as an instructor, later moved on to become an employment counselor, then program chairman. From there, I went to the district council as an executive board member. And so that kind of covers my 35 years of experience, both with the carpenters and in the union. I am also a local pastor in the greater St. Louis area. I'm a bishop, and our church do require you pay tithes. And those that can pay tithes, if you don't pay tithes, there's a certain thing called the judgment seat of Christ. So if you don't pay it in this life, you'll pay it later on. Back to business. The Carpenters Apprenticeship Program and the Carpenters District Council does as much as we are able to do on all aspects of bringing in minorities into the programs. Yes, there is a need. I'm not going to sit here and say there has not. I started in the 70s, about 78, and I know where it has come from. It took me a while to get in for a number of reasons. One, I will say to this board, was the color of my skin. The other was the economy. After having gotten in, it has been good to me. I have been able to do all that I can do. You might say, well, why do I do this job if I'm a bishop? I tell my congregation all the time, I do this job because my employer allows me to open doors for all the people like me. My specific assignment coming on board was to deal with diversity issues and to communicate back and forth through the communities. And I have done that in at least two of the states that we have named. We have gone on record, and you can show that there have been a number of programs that have been created, implemented, and we have worked towards relieving this problem time and time again. Yes, there should be a conversation that's ongoing that will address these issues. However, I will say the bill as it sits before us does nothing to help the real issue. The real issue lies between the unions, the contractors, and reaching out to the people. And so the bill as we see it right now have not addressed the real issue. I feel like I'm approaching my 3 minutes, so let me wrap up by saying this. Yes, I put my son in a pre-apprenticeship program. He went all the way through and journeyed out at the same time while going to school.
Going through the apprenticeship program, he was also able to earn college credits, which were portable all over the country. When we hit the downturn, his wife was transferred to Dallas, Texas. My son decided to drop everything and go to Dallas. Texas being a right-to-work state, I got a phone call one day. It was my son. He said, "Dad, I refuse to work in this hazardous environment for such low pay." He turned around and transferred his college credits that he earned through the apprenticeship program, and now he has gone to another career, sad to say.
Thank you, sir. Representative Burns, you're recognized for a question.
Thank you, sir. I was blessed to go through your training center, which is in my neighborhood, coincidentally. Can you tell us how many members Carpenters Union has, how many are in your, or basically, and how many are in the apprentice program, and how many are minorities?
I can address portions of that because there are certain laws that don't allow us at the district council level to track the race of people. However, at the apprenticeship level, the Bureau of Apprenticeship does require us to track it. And so our apprenticeship program for the, I was involved with the apprenticeship program for 14 years, and I'm indirectly involved with it now for about the 25 years that I've been involved with our apprenticeship program. We hover, sad to say, right around about 10%. We're up and down on that. Right about now, there's another gentleman that will testify. He might have that current number with him.
Thank you very much. But I did get in trouble at your center because my wife said, "How come you don't do stuff like that?"
I invite everybody to come down. You'll be thoroughly impressed.
Thank you, Representative Burns. Yafet Alameen. Henry Johnson.
Good afternoon. My name is Henry Johnson, and I am from the St. Louis Carpenters Joint Apprenticeship Program. And I too, Mr. Curtis, look like you as well. I did not prepare a speech, but I, in Mr. Curtis's response, he said he wasn't interested in sappy stories. He wasn't interested in success stories. Well, for him, I'm one of those success stories. But I represent the St. Louis Carpenters Joint Apprenticeship Program. I've been the curriculum director there. I've been on board for 10 years, and I would invite any and all of you to visit our training center, including Mr. Curtis. There were some comments made about not having the facts. Well, why don't you call me and I can give you the facts? First off, our program is a four-year apprenticeship program. We provide our members job skills in the form of hand skills as well as technical skills. We also, as instructors, are required to provide pathways career-wise for our apprentices. You heard my colleague Marvin reference our articulation agreements and those portable credits. So we are also involved with Bayless High School. We're involved with Ferguson-Florissant School District. We're working on a program in the near future with Oakville High School. Our work in the community has been stellar, in my opinion, because I have been in the community delivering, working at career fairs, trying to draw minorities into the programs. And I would like to agree with some of the other trade, other union programs as well, that what we've done over the last 10 years has been stellar. And certainly I don't believe we need to climb the leg of the arch any longer. So when we talk about doing things like doing a Google search for facts, well, that works out real well, doesn't it? So, you know, we don't want to do Google search for facts when I'm available. So I would just like to say to the committee that our training arm, which is the training arm of the Clarkenville District Council, opposes Bill 582, and as a minority, I also oppose Bill 582. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Mr. Tom Nellum.
Good evening. My name is Tom Nellums. I sit on the board of MOCAN. And the problem that we're having is with the union, there's so many minority companies are being forced out of business. And they're being forced out because you can't get paid by the GC. And when they get paid, the union is there with a levy at their bank and take the whole check instead of some of it. And that's one of our biggest issues with the union. And then when you start talking about boots on the ground, I don't know how they choose who they put in the field. And we haven't been able to get a meeting with them. But as it was said earlier, we could all sit down in the room. Maybe some of these things can be worked out. But we did get calls before we came up here, but it's too late to talk today, but we can talk later on. But it's an unfair playing field.
All right, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Mr. Mike Ringo.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman and everyone. My name is Mike Ringo. I'm with the Secretary Treasurer of Local 1345 and also Secretary Treasurer of the Coalition of Black Trade Unionists. And I'm here speaking against House Bill 582. And I'd just like to say that Mr. Curtis is right in the aspect that there are problems that exist, not just in the building trades, though I want him to know, but with all of the unions, the labor, the affiliated bodies, and everything. But a right to work bill is not the way to go. A lot of the speakers have come up here and said that there should have been some dialogue before we got to this point, and I totally agree with that. I've visited with Mr. Curtis in his office on more than one occasion, and he's never brought up the fact that there was problems like this that existed that would lead to something like this. But I do know from my own personal experiences that dialogue works. As I stated, there are problems that exist. And we're right now in the discussion process along with the AFL-CIO and the St. Louis Labor Council about correcting some of the problems that exist, not just in building trades, but in all of labor. We've had one meeting, we have another one scheduled, and we've already agreed to continue this throughout the year. One thing out of that resulted as a result of sitting down and talking with about some of these issues, they have both agreed to look into the creation of diversity committees so that when these issues arise, that we can sit down at a table and talk about these issues. Mr. Curtis stated that he hasn't heard from anybody that wants to suggest different ideas. Part of that's incorrect, because when I heard that this was going on, I personally emailed Mr. Curtis and also phone called his office, and I have yet to receive a call back from him on this. Recently, I've been in discussion with some of the labor leaders from around the state, and we're in the process of trying to put together a meeting where the building trades, the other union members that feel that there's injustice that's being going on, and sit down and have a meeting to work these issues out. So Mr. Curtis would be loved to be a part of that, and I wish he would, and maybe he'll get a hold of me and tell me about that. But years ago, there's always been a problem with this, okay? The need for unions arose because of...
Sir, I'm sorry, I'm going to have to cut you off. We're just out of time. Thank you very much for your testimony.
All right, thank you.
I thank everyone for testifying today. I'm terribly sorry for any who haven't had the opportunity to. But at this time, I have to conclude this hearing on House Bill 582.
Mr. Chairman, I'm sorry, you called my name, former State Representative Yaffe, I mean, I was in the restroom.
I'm terribly sorry, but I've closed the hearing. We now will go into executive session.
Thank you, Mr.
At this time, I move to do pass House Bill 116. Discussion. Representative Burns. Yes, sir. Yes, it is.
Thank you.
Madam Secretary, would you please call the roll?
Aye.
Aye.
Representative Weber.
No.
Representative Bratton.
Aye.
Representative Burns.
No.
Representative Prager.
Aye.
Representative Gosin.
Pass.
Representative Hurst. Representative Tully.
Aye.
By your vote of 9-3, you have passed House Bill 116. And I move due pass on House Bill 569. Madam Secretary, please call the roll.
Chairman Lyons.
Aye.
Vice Chair Dornan.
Aye.
Representative Weber.
No.
Representatives Bratton.
Aye.
Burns.
No.
Prager.
Aye.
Gosin.
Aye.
Hurst. Kelly.
Aye.
Lynch.
Aye.
Smith.
By your vote of 9-3, you have passed House Bill 569. I now move due pass on House Bill 582. Madam Secretary, would you please call the roll?
Chairman Lyons.
Aye.
Vice Chair Dornan.
Aye.
Representative Weber.
No.
Representative Bratton.
No.
Prager.
Aye.
Gosin.
No.
Hurst.
Aye.
Kelly.
Aye.
Lynch.
Aye.
Smith.
No.
Walker.
Aye.
By your vote of 8-4, you have passed House Bill 582. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you all for being here today. I have to admit, after a couple of testimonies, I'm sorry about missing the church service we had yesterday morning, because we got some pretty good lessons in here today.
We're in Kansas City a lot.
We're in Kansas City a lot.
I appreciate it.
And I had the most compelling story.